Aaron, so glad that you are here. We're going to have a special time learning about how God is at work in Guatemala and how we get to be a part of that. I want to introduce our long-lost pastor of missions, Gary, who's back in action, sort of, with half of a leg. Good to see you, Gary. Tell us what's up.
All right. I'm excited to be able to share about our recent trip in July. One of the things we're going to do tonight is see a feature film that Carl has been working on and editing. We saw about a five-minute version this morning, some of us who are here and during the next steps video time, and so that's a teaser for what he's been working on, and we're looking forward to that. Before we view the video, I want to ask the team to come by just one by one, introduce yourselves just at this point. We'll do maybe some brief testimonies after the video, but just come tell us where you're from and maybe what one or two things that you did on the trip. Some of you wore a lot of hats, but so let's start. Here it is. Okay. So, yeah, just let's start right here. Look.
Hi, my name is Lily Root. And during the trip, I served a lot in the children's area, hanging out with the kids while they waited for the pictures.
Yeah.
Hello, Sarah. I'm half of Lamar. I go to church here. I'm a pediatrician, so I saw kids and adults and everyone take care of the people on the trip.
And I'm Trish Springbrook, and I helped out in the kids area.
Yeah.
And then Emory Stone. And I worked with the team that did the eyeglasses.
I'm Lisa Combs, and I work in the kids' ministry at Gibbs Place, and I was on the sort of new built, so there's that.
My name is Andrew Snowden, and I was able to help in the dentist.
My name is Leah Combs, and I worked with the eyeglasses, and my sister and I did some praise and worship. She's not here tonight. Her name is Anna. She helped out in a lot of places, dentist work. She's kind of everywhere, so shout out to Anna.
I'm Jennifer Snowden, and I am Gary's daughter-in-law. We go to church at FBC Warrensburg, and I was helping in the nursing area.
Jason Snowden, Gary's son, and a family physician, and helped by seeing patients.
Hello, good evening. I'm so glad that we can be here together. My name is Chris Combs. We're from FBC Warrensbury. I was a runner, so I didn't really have a job. I ran from place to place and asked people if they needed anything, and they said, "We're fine, go away." So then I would go to the next person and ask what they needed, "We're fine, go away." But I did get to do some food distribution, which was an incredible lesson to be able to make this home and pray with them and even some people to come forward. So my name's Ray. Thank you so much for your support.
I'm Becky Combs from FBC Warrensburg, and I work mostly with the reading glasses and some books.
Hi, I'm Allison Wright, and I worked in the children's area, and I also moved back into Greece.
Hi, my name is James, here from Richard Adversley Summit, and I helped out in nursing.
Hello, everyone. They call me Nick Vaughn, and I am from FBC Warrensburg, and I just want to say thank you for everyone who prayed for us and supported us financially to go on the trip. Let's see, I did a lot of sunglasses and reading glasses, and I got to see a little bit of blood with the dentist over there, so that was always interesting.
I'm Mary Wood. I'm with the Warrensburg FBC. I mainly did reading glasses and sunglasses, and I went food distribution.
I'm Dan Ryder, and I was the dentist there. Yeah. And I had lots of help.
Hi, Dina Bagarian, and I'm a registered nurse, and I work with Dan. I was going to say my main job was to irritate Dan, but I don't think that's true.
Carol Kona, I'm a nurse, but I work with the dentist this time.
And that is our team, and I know, oops, Carl. It's indispensable, obviously, and this was the first time you'd been able to go with us on one of these trips, and I think if you saw the video this morning, you said his main job was to document, to be able to record and to capture some of our experiences. And I'm really looking forward to seeing the finished product that he's been working on and editing this evening. So with no further ado, let's watch that, and then we'll have time to share some testimonies from some of the team members, okay?
My first impressions, like how beautiful the country was and this, like the surrounding countryside. Man, we're like high up in the mountains, surrounded by some volcanoes. It's its own little paradise. Everything was green. The flowers are vibrant.
You can see just, it's lush. It's full of green, beautiful plants. You just look out across the distance and you see mountains that are near, mountains that are far, and you're winding in the car, you're winding up and down these roads.
And just the environment in which it's seated is just, was breathtaking. It was beautiful. Like God's beautiful earth. This is just really amazing to see.
Well, one of the things that never fails to, when I start to say to surprise me, it doesn't surprise me now. The fact that a group that is composed of folks who didn't know each other before the trip can just congeal and blend together.
Every time we like really come together as a group and we have a lot of fun, like with the party bus and with the card games and all that. But then we also have a really solid time just like serving.
Once you get together and you serve together and you're serving Christ and you're serving each other and you get to focus on what's important, it's loving God with everything you are and likewise loving your neighbor as yourself.
I think back to the description of the book of Acts, the early church, the unanimity, the harmony, the oneness that characterized them. I see that every time I take a trip with a group of folks to Guatemala. And I think that comes from the heart giving to service, focusing on needs outside of yourself. I think that is so critical, and it seems to shove ego and self-centeredness and own personal interests aside. In the greater scheme of things, we're here to serve others. And I saw that again this year in just so many powerful ways.
The work that God was already doing through the local churches, we helped open some doors with medical clinics and just a volume of people, but the local churches were really getting into taking God to their neighbors.
This time I did what I normally do on most of these trips, and that was doing the intake. I'm usually the first point of contact when the people come to want to see the doctor. So I take their name and their age and their complaints, whatever symptoms they're suffering from, and note those and give them a number on the back of their hand, a number on the sheet that corresponds that will follow them through their doctor's process.
So I think my primary role was as a nurse to help intake. Whenever we go to the clinics, we would see up to 100 different individuals through the day. And after getting a brief health physical, we would help triage and make sure we got to the right doctor. We would take blood pressures, blood sugars. We would clean and dress some wounds. We would do some minor procedures.
I am a pediatrician, so definitely have a big heart for the kids that are coming through, but we'll see all ages as well.
My number one goal was wherever I needed to be. I wanted God to use, like, I wanted to be God's hands and feet. And so I didn't really have a specific goal. I just knew that there were a lot of people that were specific to certain medical fields. And honestly, wherever people needed me is where I wanted to go. And I got really good at talking to people in Spanish, specifically about sunglasses and glasses. It was really cool. But then I also like branched out a little bit and got to help the dentist out a little bit.
So when we were in the clinic, I was helping with the eyeglass station. And I was helping people pick out a bag for their their eyeglasses that we'd just given them, and also like a cleaning cloth for their glasses. And I got to talk with them a little bit, and I tried to use my Spanish. But it was fun to see people, and it was fun to see them smile when they put their glasses on and actually be able to read.
You know, there's always a little bit of language barrier with the Spanish and English, but somehow, like, God gives you clarity. God gives you what you need in order to communicate between them. And so the bond that I made was so special. There was our translators, Alex, Stephanie, you know, Carlos, they were so amazing to us. And we had such a fun time together, but they helped carry out our mission trip as well. And the Guatemalan people and I, if they have Christ, I have Christ, that's the biggest bond, you know. They were helpful and they were generous, and they were willing to receive what we wanted to give them.
I met one of our translators named Stephanie when we were working at the eyeglass station, and I loved her. I loved her personality, and she was really good at English, so it was easier for me to talk to her. But she was so sweet and so kind and always wanting to help, and I felt like I got really close to her on the trip, and I just really enjoyed being around her. That was a really good connection that I made.
So my role when I was in Guatemala was to document the experience of everything that was going on. We really just wanted to share the stories of what's going on so that we can continue to help the local churches do what God has set on their hearts to do.
I filled medicine bags that were distributed out. I began cleaning dental tools for Mr. Dan and Ms. Dina. I switched from just cleaning dental tools to full on helping in the dental office, which I really enjoyed that experience in that process for the final clinic day. It was really cool to see how, like, even including even the dentist's office and food bags and all these different places, how Christ was reflected through, like, basically the whole clinic.
We would deliver food bags to specific homes and specific people, and it was really just us coming alongside the local church and doing and helping the ministry that they were already doing, but literally meeting people and their neighbors where they are.
I delivered food bags a couple times, and I was the only person in the group that we went with that could speak some Spanish and some English, so it was a little scary, but it was really cool because we went to several houses, and I could understand what they were praying for, and it was really moving. It was incredible. And it was just really, it was a blessing to be able to give them food and to be able to be used in that way.
Like, we went, I think, to four different families, and every single one, like, they had nothing. Their house had, like, absolutely nothing. It was, like, just barely standing house and, like, a tin metal roof that sufficed as a roof. And maybe if there were holes in it, there was a tarp that went down. And it just, like, wow, their bedroom was the living room and it was the kitchen, but they had these plastic chairs and there was always enough places. Some even offered us food. Like, they have nothing and they're giving it to us. They're saying, come into my house. You're welcome here. And, like, so welcoming and so grateful for everything.
So when we went in their homes, they were very welcoming. They immediately went as fast as they could to grab chairs for us and to let us sit down. There was one man that we met. He walked out with crutches on, and he had his foot wrapped up, and we figured out that he had a really bad burn on his foot, and it was hard for him to walk. But he was saying, even though his circumstances were bad, he still trusted God, and he had God in his heart. And he said, thank you for what you're doing. You guys are part of a bigger vision, and that really impacted me.
It was kind of unique to be invited in, like, it felt kind of like as a stranger being welcomed in like a family member, like a friend you haven't seen in a long time. Oh, it's so great that you're here. Please, please come into my home.
Got invited into someone's house, and it was a couple. It was a man and a woman and their son, who was probably not more than three. And Pastor Luis shared the gospel message with them, and they just went to the floor, face first to the floor, and prayed.
Watching families literally drop to their knees and in prayer, and then the group joining them, joining around them, on the floor of their living room or the floor of their, the dirt floor of their bedroom, kitchen, their whole home.
And they were bawling their eyes out and just repenting and praying to God. Just simple hospitality of meeting in someone's home or meeting somebody where they're at. Some people are just ready to receive Christ. They just need to hear it. They just need someone who knows Christ to deliver the message, and he will finish the work.
One of the coolest moments is we went in and we got to see one of the families accept Christ right there. I think there was four people, and two of them I think knew Christ and accepted them in their heart, and two did not. And at the end of the day, they were able to receive Christ right there. And the pastor's daughter, who spoke perfect Spanish, was able to converse in their language with them and talk about the importance of receiving Christ's blood, Christ's love into their heart. And she made the most important decision. It was such a glorious moment.
As we would have conversations about, do you go to church or do you have a church family or how can we, we have this very small token of food that will get you by for a few more days, but can we tell you about Jesus? Can we tell you about God? So it's this everlasting, this bread of life that can fill you forever.
Yeah, there were multiple people who accepted God, and I know we've been praying for that so hard. I heard that when they went into the houses, they were sharing about Jesus, and a couple decided to accept Jesus, and they just fell face down on the ground and were pouring out their hearts to Jesus, and they were confessing and they were accepting Jesus in their hearts. And that was so powerful. That was amazing. Their lives are changed forever.
There were several moments that I think that were really, really moving to me. One, I think in particular, was the day that James Guise, we stole him away from his nursing responsibilities to accompany us on the food bag deliveries.
On one of the food delivery days, I got to join six other individuals, three from the local church and then some from our group. We hopped in the back of a little bitty Nissan truck and had six or seven food bags and took off down dirt alleys and small roads and tiny alleyways, at one point through a cornfield.
And I think it was a God-ordained moment because one of the homes we went to, the mom was very concerned for a 25-year-old son who suffered cancer that was up in his upper shoulder and chest, and he had just had chemo the day before. And James was able just to give some very practical, helpful advice about post-chemo treatments, the things that they need to be looking for and activities that they should be doing. And so I think that was, a really special moment. And then James just led in a beautiful prayer to the Lord for that young man's health and for God to bring healing and for his mom to have peace in the midst of all that. That was a really special moment, I think, for me.
I mean, Tabitha is always really powerful. It's like every year, it's almost like more impactful each time.
As we drive through the city, we drive by the city dump that is overflowing. And there's families living in and around it.
It was just getting to see the situation the kids were in and how much struggles and difficulties they were living through and how much God was working through that ministry and how much he was helping those kids.
We get to Tabitha Ministry and we unload off the bus. The doors were like big metal doors you walk through. And so we go up these stairs and it's really, really narrow. And Gary stands up and shares a whole lot about like how Tabitha Ministries came to be. And Carol comes in and she does this entire spiel of the history of it. She left everything behind because she saw there was a need and it broke her heart.
And hearing the stories of children not having a place to sleep, not having a safe place to be, living in the dirt, living in the garbage.
It was a school for the children who'd been living in a dump. They had nothing. They were abused and alone and they had no home. And they were living in the dumps, and there was trash everywhere. But they built a school for the kids, and the kids were able to come and learn so that they could get out of the dumps and get out of their situation.
Disease, sickness, like really terrible sickness, gangs going around. And so this is the place they go for safety. This is where they seek shelter. This is where they go to eat twice a day for every single day of the year, you know? Carol was used by the Holy Spirit to empower these kids, to give them hope, to give them new life. Not only do they get an education there, but they also get to know Christ there.
They come to Tabith Ministries, they get food and they get an education. Seeing them praise God and dance and be happy and sing and have a chance to be children in a safe environment through the ministry that God has supplied right there in that community and the love of those teachers.
To see those kids receiving love and care and food each day, it warms my heart. It gives me a sense of joy to know that our church takes on that task each year of sustaining that vital, vital ministry there in Guatemala City.
We were in a room sitting down, and the kids came in and they were singing. They started singing some songs.
But to just like hear those children who have essentially nothing singing about like the goodness of God and how much God provides for them and that God is enough.
It was such a powerful moment, and I'm just sobbing, and this one girl comes up and she puts her arm around me and she's rubbing my shoulder and comforting me as I'm crying, and I'm like, I'm supposed to be comforting you.
And I could not contain myself. I was bawling my eyes out. Even just thinking about it was is emotional for me.
The lyrics of the songs just touched all of our hearts, and then a couple of young ladies did some dances, and it was just really, really powerful and beautiful and moving to watch.
To hear from a girl who had actually grown up in Tabitha, and to hear her words that she was going to college, to see that, just to see like what that ministry has done in her life, and her just like thankfulness for that, and then to see her also like pour back into that ministry as well. So that was particularly powerful for me this time.
And then at the end, all the kids just flooded into where we were seated.
And the kids came over and hugged us.
We were just like bawling and like happy, joyful, broken tears. I just remember watching David, he just picked up this little girl as if it was his own child and just was holding her like a father would hold his daughter.
And they're hugging us, and everything within me, I just like wrap my arms around them and I hold them so, so tight, because I just want them to know, like, again, even though I can't say anything to you, like, man, I love you and God loves you. They don't realize that when we're hugging them, it's with everything we have. Like, you are amazing. You are loved. We understand. I specifically understand your situation, but hang in there, because it's gonna be okay, and God loves you. For these kids to come up to me and hug me, it was like, thank you for believing in me. This is how we're using the money that you give, and it's empowering us as children. Like, this is what we get because of your generosity. Just filled with so many emotions at that point, overwhelmed, satisfied.
And I was, as I was hugging them, I was like, oh, you're safe. It's so good that you're safe and you're being protected, and they were precious. When we come on a mission trip, we always think that God's gonna move in the people there and that we're gonna be a huge blessing to them. And it is like that. But what I find every time is that God moves in me and the people are a blessing to me. And I really saw God moving in my life. Especially when we were at the church, people were just worshiping with their whole hearts. Even though they had nothing, they gave their whole heart to God to worship Him. And I felt the Holy Spirit moving there. It was a beautiful moment, and I definitely saw God in the hearts of the people here.
My expectations changed greatly. I mean, I expected that we were gonna be coming into the country, we were going to bless other people, but what I realized is like, I was the one that was blessed. Like, they were blessing me. Here are people who have nothing. They literally have nothing, and they're over here grateful for the most smallest things possible.
What I saw there fundamentally changed me, and it just let me know that like, what I saw them doing there, my Christian Guatemalan brothers and sisters, I learned from them how to be with people and how to approach people and what to do and to have no fear and just to really be considering like what people need to hear in the gospel and to help provide for people's needs. And I think when I saw people coming to Christ and praying and repenting and crying and receiving the gospel, that it just reminded me that like he is all powerful and he's God of everything, and that when we take the risk to share the gospel, like that seems so scary, but people are ready to receive it. Some people will say yes, and they're going to take that information just like we did, and they're going to celebrate their new life with Christ, and they're going to go on living with him. And I think that it's just an important reminder that like God is powerful. God can work in people's lives. Like the Holy Spirit is there to help people take that step of faith and say, I'm going to trust and follow Jesus with my life.
To me, that's always one of the highlights of the trips. I never fail to be moved by those experiences as we go into homes that are so humble. I don't know how many dirt floors we saw, sometimes just a one-room house with a single light bulb maybe to illuminate it, that served as living room, kitchen, bedroom, everything. No indoor plumbing, typically, and stuff. And yet, despite the poverty, as we presented, especially where the gospel was shared with those folks when they weren't Christians, to see the response to those people, we had, of course, several folks who prayed to receive Christ, which is always a tremendous blessing, a source of joy for us. But also the gratitude that they expressed to us just was amazing.
He changed my outlook on like what it means to truly be happy. No money can suffice. No roof over your head can suffice. But the amount of joy they have for the Lord, they would say, I'm blessed. They would say that they are blessed because they have their family and they have Christ in their home. Like the biggest thing is like, I don't need all this other stuff. I need God every minute of the day. No money, no house, no tangible item could suffice. And I learned that just by going to Guatemala.
It's a good reminder to see that even people who live in a metal shack with like nothing but plastic chairs and a mattress on the ground can still be happy and still have joy because they don't have as much to distract them from Christ. And I really feel like that's something I'm gonna take away this trip.
God really changed my worship here because I got to see people in a church that, you know, had nothing and they still gave everything to God, like all their praise, their whole heart, all of their worship. And I just want to continue to worship like that. I was able to just praise God freely, and it was a beautiful moment. And now my worship has changed because now I know that you can give your whole heart no matter what you have.
God can move through anyone and anything. He has a purpose for everyone and everything. And he uses everyone to further his kingdom. Something that opened my eyes this week was be willing to be used by God and be willing to be open to what he wants for you.
Some are called to preach. Some are called to heal. Some are called to have a soft hand and clean a wound, put a new bandage on. Some are called to put on a clown suit and play with kids and blow bubbles and make kids smile. Others are to play games. Others are to extract teeth. And others are to deliver food and clean tools. That whatever small skill that God has given me that I can provide back in service, that he can take whatever small ability that he's given me and can multiply it so many more times.
Well done, Carl. Well done. Thank you, sir, for your efforts in documenting that trip. Thank you.
Carl is a wizard when it comes to editing film and putting things together, and we're grateful for those talents. And I think he told the story and captured it well. But I want to give a few of you the opportunity this evening before we enjoy some refreshments, and that's for everybody, that, you know, even if you already snacked during the Chiefs game or something like that. If there's still room, there's lots of food back there that we can enjoy together afterwards. But let's take just a few minutes. I wanted to ask a few folks just to come and share briefly what most impacted you on the trip. What was most memorable? How did you see God using the experience in your own life? And I ask Lily to begin for us.
Good evening. My name again is Lily Root, and I've been able to go to Guatemala multiple times. I believe my mom and I's first trip was around 13 years ago, maybe. And when we left this trip, I just kept talking to my mom about how much the ministry down there has grown. A ministry that's near and dear to our hearts specifically is Tabitha. I'm a school teacher and I love working with the kids, and so that's something I've done every time I've gone down there. And just to see the construction grow, to see these kids start as babies in there and then be able to graduate and go to college and then spend time back at Tabitha, helping out Carol and loving on the kids at Tabitha was something that was very memorable for me. And it's definitely something that I wish to continue to support as well. And before I pass the microphone, I wanted to thank our church congregation for their financial support through your words of encouragement and your support through prayer. And I also wanted to give a special shout out to the crafters group. The bags are very much loved by the Guatemalan people, the medicine bags, the eyeglass holders, everything, the hats. When they get an extra something, their smiles just multiply. So thank you so much for your support and thank you for all you do.
Someone else from the team would like to share. Dan?
I'll pass it in just a minute. This is my second trip there, and, you know, Dina and Carol are RNs. They now have another pair of letters at the end of their credentials as far as being a dental hygienist and dental assistant. I could not have done that without you, so thank you, thank you. We saw 110 people over the time. That's probably more than double what I would have been able to see by myself. Now, if you also helped me, raise your hand. Just about everybody else that was there. And so, yeah, so thank you for that. I'll echo the amount of passion that the Guatemalan people have for God. Probably the thing that, aside from Tabitha, which is very, very moving, and what a wonderful ministry that we celebrate. I think when Chris gave the message at one of the churches on Sunday morning and Jason translated for him. He used the phrase, "You people worship hard," something similar to that anyway. And the passion that they show, we say they have nothing, but they have everything. It truly is really heart-wrenching to see their love for Christ. The second thing is the five people on that row back there are my family. I would like my family to meet my new family. I now have two. How lucky can I be? So thank our church for the support, and thank you for the special relationship that you have allowed me to have with you. Jace. Oh, you have it.
There we go. Yeah, it's working. Okay, so I'm Jason Combs. And I just want to share about some food deliveries we did. So I got to go on two of those, but the second time in the shady pickup truck that Mr. James talked about in the video, I got to go with him on that. And we got to go into this lady's house that had like one room, and there was a guy in a bed back there, and I don't exactly remember how he got hurt, but he was hurt pretty bad, and the lady, I couldn't understand what she was saying, but she just started praying and just bawling her eyes out, and the translators were trying to do their best, and one of those things that really stuck out to me that they translated was, like, this lady was in this house that was made of, like this tin house with, like, this tarp roof, and she still said, "God has blessed my life," and that's, like, the last thing I thought she would have said, and that just stuck with me, and, like, I don't know, like, all that I have, like, I don't know if I've ever just confessed, like, "God has blessed my life" like that, and she's got, like, nothing. And that was just really powerful, and yeah.
Thank you, Jason. Someone else? Oh, yeah, absolutely.
All right, okay. Oh, thank you. Sorry. Hello again. My name is Dina Bagarian, and I tried to write down some thoughts this afternoon just very briefly. But so I was asked to share what stood out to me the most during the trip to Guatemala. The Tabitha ministry has consistently been the most moving and memorable experience when I have visited Guatemala, this being my third trip. It is with an extremely heavy and burdened heart that all of you must be informed that these impoverished and vulnerable children are living with enormous targets on their small backs. The staff at Tabitha spoke of drug cartels coming to Tabitha, at times even providing a lure of much needed food or other supplies. And, excuse me, and other types of assistance for these children. It is recently estimated under our current administration that there are at least 325,000 children who have crossed our porous southern borders that are now completely unaccounted for. These little ones, God's precious children, often as young as 8 years old, are often being kidnapped, drugged, and then cross our southern border with traffickers claiming to be their parents. It should send an icy chill up the spine of every Bible-believing Christian, it does mine, to recall the words of our blessed Savior in Luke 17. "It would be better for him to have a millstone hung around his neck and he were cast into the sea than he should cause one of these little ones to sin." Please join me in a moment of silent prayer for these children. Thank you. I would also like to quote Habakkuk 2, "But the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth keep silence before him." Thank you.
Thank you, Dina. Anyone else? Okay, Nick.
Yeah. Well, good evening, guys. My name is Nick Vaughn. I attend FBC Warrensburg. And it's been a great pleasure to go on this trip with everyone. And one of the things, I guess I should start by saying, is like the whole trip was super impactful. But the thing that impacted me the most was probably Tabitha ministry. I come from a background of abuse as well. I come from a background where I was adopted. So I understand a lot of the things that those little kids were going through. And just to be there and to see them praising with such joy in their heart was like an eye-opener to me. When I was their age, I didn't know Christ, you know. I wouldn't blame them if they had the same mentality that I had when I was going through what they were going through. It was like, well, if there's a God, why would he allow such terrible things to happen? You know, that was kind of my thought. Like, there's no way God is real. And I heard the word God all around me. I knew there was a higher power. I just didn't want to accept it. And then my mom, who adopted me, was like, "Well, he loves you so much that he saw there's a need for you to be away from your biological family.
And so you would have an opportunity to be adopted, to be raised in the right way. And I was like, oh, I've never heard about it that way. So these are kids who were, I don't know, 5, maybe even a little younger. And they had Christ in their heart. They had tough situations, and they were not naive to it. They knew their situation was hard. And in the middle of that, they still chose to praise God with everything they had. And I would say, just like the video set up there, I went expecting to kind of help out wherever I needed, but I really thought I was going to be a blessing to others. But the truth is, I was blessed by them. That's the truth. And I do want to give a shout out to Carl. Way to go on that video. I mean, tons of work, guys. He did a lot of work on that video, and it really did show. So thank you, thank you, thank you.
Okay. I'll give one more chance for anybody. Jen?
And you saw, I'm going to cry, I'm sorry. The last Sunday we were there, we all had the opportunity to split up and go to the 2 churches that we were able to serve with through the week. And like was mentioned in the video, our job is just to go and support the work that's already being done there. And so the most beautiful moment the entire week was during praise and worship. And Anna and Leah were leading with a couple of our guys on drums. And I look over during the song is the goodness of God, and then we were singing it in Spanish. And Pastor Luis had gone down to the front and was laying face down on the ground, just weeping. And then here I see Chris come alongside him, gets down on the ground, kneeling in front of the church, and just puts his arm around him. And just all around him, the church was just worshiping and praising God. And I was like, that's the picture of what we're doing here this week. Our job is to come alongside and to work alongside our brothers and sisters in Christ in Guatemala. And thank you again for the opportunity that we get to go to put a medical clinic together and to do all the other activities to be able to support the churches, to help them to draw people in. That they may not have touch points with in their community, but then to be able to go out and minister even more. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Jim. And it is incredible to recognize what God does through the prayers of his people. And we know that this kind of trip would not be possible without the faithful prayers of our church members, both at First Baptist Warrensburg here at First Baptist Lee Summit. We want to express from the bottom of our heart our deepest gratitude for your prayers, for the finances that make a trip like this possible, for the ongoing support of the Tabitha ministry and other things that we get to touch. There's been a lot of talk about the longevity of these projects, the ongoing. That is a core commitment that I have. There are churches that go, okay, this summer we're going to go here, next summer we'll go here, and we might never see those people again. That's one way to do missions, but that's not the way to establish relationships that transform lives. And we have seen lives transform through the long-standing relationships we have with Guatemala Christians and now also in Cuba over the last several years there as well. So I want to always be a part of a church that is committed to that kind of longevity and heartfelt relationships, because that's where you get to experience joys, sadness, and just to share the love of Christ in such tangible ways. So again, thank you all so much for your prayer support, for the gifts that made that possible. Unless anyone has a final word, I'm going to say there's lots of food out in the foyer there in the chapel area. Help yourself, and let's enjoy some fellowship time. And if you have some questions for anybody, I'm sure they'd be happy to answer. Let's pray before we go. Gracious Father, thank you so much for the opportunity you've given us here this evening to gather, to celebrate what you did in and through this team in Guatemala back in July. Lord, we're grateful for the protection that you gave us. We're grateful for the lives that were touched, for the people who came into an eternal relationship with Christ, having heard the gospel and received it, for those who received medical treatments that were so necessary for them, those who are now being able to read the scriptures because they can see them, because they received reading glasses, and just so many other tangible expressions of your love. And so We pray for our brothers and sisters there in Cuba, for the especially the two churches with whom we served this past summer, and for others that we've served with in the past, that you would continue to bless their efforts, extend the gospel, give them, Father, fruit for their efforts, and we'll celebrate that with them in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you so much.